You know, I think it's a pretty generally agreed upon thing that Sonic 4 Episode 1 isn't the best game ever. And I think in my past videos, I've done a fine enough job of representing that I do not like the game too much. So what better way to torture myself than making me play through the very game that I hate with a limitation that will make me hate it even more? That's right, today we're gonna be finding out if you can beat Sonic 4 Episode 1 without the homing attack. This includes air dashes as well, basically anything where you press the A button while you're in the air counts as a homing attack. Also, Proa helped with this challenge. He does with literally everyone now, so I don't know what you expected. I don't want to waste any more of your time because this whole thing's pretty self-explanatory, so let's get into the challenge. Just like literally every other challenge I've done, the first level, Splash Hill Zone 1, is like a testing ground for your new limitations. It's a fairly easy level and helps you get accommodated to how slow it takes you to reach top speed without air dashes. But yeah, you can pretty much just run through the level as you normally would, except a lot slower, and reach the end. In Splash Hill Zone 2, the difficulty ramps up quite a bit because there's like 10 million homing attack chains that the game wants you to do. A lot of times, Sonic 4 will have this thing where they put a bunch of enemies back to back and they just want you to spam the A button so you'll homing attack chain into them basically to proceed through the level. Sometimes this is just used to get to a higher up path, but sometimes it is used to block all progression. And most of them start appearing in Splash Hill 2. You pretty much just have to take the bottom path and try to ignore all of the homing attack chains and just run under them. That strategy was going well for me until I reached a checkpoint where the bottom path forced you to do a homing attack chain and the top path also seemed to force you to do a homing attack chain. The bottom path was a definite no-go, so I turned my attention to the upper path, and it's actually pretty easy. With a bit of luck, you can make a jump right here onto the left side of these spikes, which you don't fall off of for some reason, and then all I have to do is jump over them and proceed. Despite there being homing attack chains absolutely everywhere, we can somehow avoid all of them and complete Splash Hill 2. Now, if Splash Hill 2 is hard, then Splash Hill 3 is like really hard. What's something harder than hard? Solid, strong, tough, concentrated. Okay, if Splash Hill 2 is hard, then Splash Hill 3 is impenetrable. Everything seems fine at first, but if you're taking the bottom path, you are going to run into a roadblock pretty quickly. It has a section where you have to go on this spring, and then you're supposed to do a small homing attack chain to proceed, but we can't do that, obviously. In any other 2D Sonic game, we could probably just hit this spring and then hold down right and go over these enemies. But for whatever reason, in Sonic 4, once you hit a spring, you cannot move horizontally until you're already falling. So we already had to watch out for homing attack chains, but springs that lead into homing attack chains like this are going to be the death of us. And as you'll see later in this challenge, there are a lot of springs that lead into homing attack chains. So while experimenting here to see if you could get past this section, I found some Sonic 4 tech. Yeah, that's right, a Sonic 4 life hack that'll help us get past. So in most classic Sonic games, when you get hit, the way you get sent flying is determined by the direction you're facing, where the enemy hit you, and some other stuff. Either that or it's just random, but I'm pretty sure there's some algorithm to it because you can get your damage boost direction consistent if you have a consistent setup. But in this game, it's simplified to be just the opposite of the direction you're facing. So if you turn left right before you hit the enemy, you can be damage boosted to the right. But because springs are so broken in this game, this isn't even enough to help us. So we're gonna have to restart and try and take the top path instead, which will likely only be harder. So if we restart and go in the top path, it's going to seem impossible because there is yet another spring that leads into a homing attack chain. But on this one, the homing attack chain is actually going down, so we can use the damage boost trick to get by it. But this trick is actually a lot more finicky than you think, because you can't jump into the spring and do it, you can't spin dash into the spring and do it. No, you have to stand exactly right here on the edge of the flowers, hold down right, and then hit the spring, and then that will give you the right amount of momentum to do it. For whatever reason, hitting the spring in any other way does not work. I have no idea why. So from here, we can continue in the level, and everything seems fine, and we can actually get decently close to the end. But here we reach another small homing attack chain, pretty similar to the one earlier from the bottom path. It's pretty much identical, once again, a spring into a small homing attack chain, so we're gonna have to find some way to get around it because the damage boost trick doesn't work here either. Earlier on in the level, there's actually a secret path you can take by breaking down this wall, which usually just takes you to the same place we were just at, but a little bit faster. But I theorize that doing a spin dash jump off of this higher platform might be able to get over this homing attack chain. Sadly, after trying it quite a few times, times I could not get enough distance, but I still do have one more trick up my sleeve. Quite a ways back in the level, there's a speed up monitor, and I thought that maybe hitting this would give our spin dash jump just the little bit of extra momentum it needed to make it over. But in Sonic 4, monitors don't last super long, so after we hit it, we are against the clock to try and get to the place where we need to do the spin dash jump. It isn't easy and it takes some finesse, but it also isn't the hardest trick in the world to get it there. So we can actually keep the speed up all the way to the part where we do the spin dash jump and then do the spin dash jump, and we can actually make it over this small homing attack chain from earlier. So continuing from this point, I thought that we were nearly at the end and there's no way this is getting any harder, but I was wrong. The very last obstacle in this level is a giant pit that you're supposed to do a homing attack chain over. Ugh. Similar to the last issue though, there is a higher up platform a little bit back to the left. And so from here, I thought maybe we could do another spin dash jump to clear the gap. Getting up to this platform though, isn't really that easy because we have to do another damage boost, which is pretty difficult by the way, and we have to avoid these projectiles. Yes, it is possible to get up there, but it takes quite a few tries. Furthermore, spin dash jumping from there doesn't even get us far enough to hit the first badnik. So once again, I thought maybe we could keep the speed up monitor until this section of the level and then use that extra speed to clear the gap. However, the speed up monitor is like halfway through the level, and this is right at the end of the level, and so I didn't know if it would be possible to carry it all the way to the end. Also, even getting up to this platform in the first place is a chore, and doing it first try takes a lot of skill. So the plan would be to hit this monitor, be fast enough that we keep it until we reach the end of the level, do a pretty difficult trick first try, and then hope that the spin dash jump is enough to clear the gap. I honestly don't even know if it's possible to carry the speed monitor all the way over here. I don't think it is. It might be with like task level precision, but that's obviously not something I have. So I have come to the conclusion that Splash Hill 3 is not possible for now. See, this is the only one of these challenges I've done that we can actually do the special stages in. All we have to do is carry 50 rings to the end of the level and grab the emerald. No homing attacks required. And we have a bit more luck on our side because after we beat Splash Hill 1, every single level in the game becomes accessible. The jump in Splash Hill 3 is likely possible if you have supersonic, so we just have to hope that 7 out of the 12 stages in the game are possible to beat without homing attacks so we can get all 7 chaos emeralds and then go back and do whatever other stages have issues and then get around those issues with supersonic. We can get the first two emeralds from Splash Hill 1 and 2, so let's skip Splash Hill 3 for now and see if we can find 5 other levels out of the 9 remaining that are possible so we can get the chaos emeralds in them and get supersonic. Alright, Casino Ripoff Zone Act 1 is fairly easy. Like, really easy. I can't even think of anything to discuss with it because it's so easy. We can beat the level with 50 rings easily and get our third chaos emerald. Ripoff Zone Act 2 is a bit of a special case, so I want to talk about that later. Casino Ripoff Zone Act 3 is pretty easy until the final section where, you guessed it, there's a big homing attack chain over a bottomless pit. But for some reason, right before giant gaps in their levels, the programmers decided to put platforms high up to the left, and there's one here too with a secret monitor on it. And we can just barely get up there by bouncing on these badniks. Spin dash jumping from here isn't enough to clear the gap, but it probably would be if we had supersonic, so let's throw this one in the supersonic pile with Splash Hill 3. Okay, now the time has come to talk about Lost Labyrinth Zone. Oh boy. Okay, this entire zone is already painful enough when you're playing it normally, but it's somehow even worse without the homing attack. Act 1 is pretty bad, but not nearly as terrible as what is about to come, except for this part where you're falling on this ball, and if you move, you die instantly. That's a really cool mechanic. Especially considering right before this drop, you have to be moving so that you don't die, and there's no indication that if you keep moving, you will die. Great. Act 2 is so bad for so many reasons. This torch gimmick is stupid, and most of the time you're just sitting there waiting for this stupid TNT to blow up. And the level is so excruciatingly long, and this music track just ingrains itself into your brain as you slowly go insane from trying to play the worst zone in Sonic 4 without taking any breaks, and the music in this game isn't even that bad except for this stupid-sounding synth that is used in every single song. Act 3 has these ridiculous water chamber things that basically insta-kill you. Lucky for me, I knew how to handle them already, but it is such a stupid thing to put in. It also has you outrunning a wall, which you can usually just air dash to get far in front of, but I can't do that, so I had to actually memorize the layout of this area so I know when to jump and slow down, and why is this spring not working at all? Just bounce me up! Oh, it gets even better. Right at the end of this level, where you have to hit these two switches to open the gate at the end of the level, I was so close, and I hit both of the switches, but then the game decided it wanted to make me feel even more pain, and after hitting both of the switches, the door wouldn't open up, so I had to play the whole level again. Why are you doing this to me? I just want content for my YouTube channel. After we beat all three levels, we can unlock the boss, which is the stupidest boss in this game. Oh yeah, let's just make a thing that can one-hit crush the player with very little little warning, and it's more about memorizing the patterns and redoing it over and over instead of actually testing their skill. That'll be a real great boss. Oh man, and in the boss music, that stupid synth instrument is still there. Like, how did they mess this up so bad? The actual songs are pretty dang good, but this one instrument ruins the whole thing. Da 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 da. This is a challenge I would never want to bring upon another person just because of Lost Labyrinth. All three levels in it are possible to beat and get the Chaos Emerald in, which brings our total potential emerald count up to 6. I need to go take a break, my lungs hurt. We only have 3 levels left in Mad Gear, and as long as one is possible, we will be able to get all 7 emeralds and get Supersonic, likely saving this challenge. Mad Gear 1 goes in the pile of stages you need Supersonic to beat. There's a homing attack chain that you can't get past about halfway through the level, standard deal at this point. Mad Gear 2 is another special case, we'll talk about that later, which just leaves Mad Gear 3 as our final opportunity to save this challenge. Like Lost Labyrinth 2, there is a giant crush wall, which usually air dashing can help us get further in front of, but we can't do that, so instead, once again, it's more memorization and trying to do it as fast as we can without losing our 50 rings. Mad Gear 3 is not an easy level by any means, and not getting hit throughout basically the entire thing is difficult. But with enough trial and error, we can actually reach the end of the level, which gives us our final Chaos Emerald opportunity, meaning we can go get Supersonic. But first, because I was an idiot and didn't get them as I went, I had to go back and beat all 7 possible levels again with 50 rings to have one shot at getting an emerald. This means I get to play through the entirety of Lost Labyrinth again multiple times, because most special stages took a few tries. I'll spare you the baby rage again, because I think I've already done that enough, but long story short, the special stages in this game are actually pretty challenging, and I spent a good few extra hours replaying stages to beat them and get all the emeralds. Alright, now that we have all the emeralds, we can go back to Splash Hill 3, go super, and do a spin dash jump to clear the gap, just as expected. Same thing goes for Casino Street 3 and Mad Gear 1, making those 3 levels now possible. Things are looking up for us. Now that we have Supersonic, there's no homing attack chain that can stop. Oh. Yeah, so Casino Ripoff Zone 2 is the only level with these cards that you have to homing attack onto to activate and proceed. And to activate these cards, you don't have to homing attack once, not twice, but 3 times just to get one deck to activate. These cards show up multiple times throughout the level, and I know that at least the first one is unskippable. The second and third decks might be skippable with some crazy trick, but we know this level has a minimum of 3 homing attacks. On the PC version. Come on, Sonic 4, you try and throw us a challenge, but we are always 3 steps ahead of you. Because in the mobile version of the game, there are 2 levels that are different from every other version. Guess what one of those levels is? Casino Street 2! I'm sorry for the really low quality footage here, it'll go back to normal soon, I just need to record footage from my phone real quick, it's only for a couple scenes, I swear. In the mobile version of this level, you just have to keep going in this pinball machine over and over until you get 100,000 points, and then the gate to the end opens up, and the level's super tedious and boring, but there's no homing attacks required, which automatically makes it better than the PC version. The only other level that's changed is Lost Labyrinth 2, but I tested it out and made sure it's still possible to beat and get an emerald in. I actually don't even think it's possible to die in this stage at all, so this might get kind of confusing, but from now on we're talking about the amount of homing attacks in the mobile version. We'll come back to it all at the end, it'll make more sense, I swear. Okay, now I'm switching back to PC footage because it's easier for me to record, and everything else across versions is the exact same, so it doesn't even make a difference. The only problematic level left we have to check out is Mad Gear 2, and oh my gosh, it's another spring into a homing attack, are you kidding me? So right at the start of the level we have this vertical section here, and where we use the homing attack to hit the bad Nick, and then the shield monitor again to get over this section. I tried damage boosting and doing a bunch of other weird stuff, but none of it ended up working. Supersonic can't help us here because we need 50 rings to go super, and this is right at the start before we can collect that many rings. So I accepted the fact that we need to do at least one homing attack here, but it seems like you need to do 2, so I started to try and somehow get it down to just 1. Here my idea was to use invincibility frames to get through the bad Nick so I could lock onto the monitor and skip the first homing attack, but somehow I just ended up bouncing in a really convenient way and got through with just 1 homing attack. We'll get back to this in a second, don't worry. The rest of Mad Gear 2 is really easy, and after beating it, we get to see this godlike cutscene. Like, just let this play out. Whew, they must have hired Pixar to handle that one. After that, we get to Egg Station Zone, which is just a boss rush. I know I didn't mention any of the bosses besides Lost Labyrinth, but that's because they're all super duper easy and we can blast through them without issue. I thought maybe the Mad Gear boss would be more difficult, and yeah, it's a bit harder, but it really isn't anything too bad. After beating all the other bosses again, we get to fight this 26 hit absolute mad lad. This boss is not boring or repetitive whatsoever. It's super fun, I promise you. After dying and restarting far more times than I'd like to admit, we can dodge the final attack and complete the Sonic 4 No Homing Attack Challenge. So, can you beat Sonic 4 Episode 1 without the homing attack? No. But how many homing attacks it takes is kind of up to you. I mean, the mobile version still counts as a version of the game, okay? So I think it takes one, but some might say three or however many Casino Street has. We didn't fully test that. It's kind of a gray area, but I am willing to accept that you can beat Sonic 4 Episode 1 with only one homing attack. No. You know what? We have gotten around boundaries that I did not think we could get around. We have worked through this game with just barely enough Chaos Emeralds to save us from having a homing attack number in the double digits. I am not going to sit here and let the developers ruin my challenge video on YouTube.com just because I can't get past this pitiful jump because of how springs don't work right. That's why I am offering a bounty to this challenge, and you can claim it. I will gift a copy of Sonic Mania or just $20. You'll probably just pick $20, but you know. To whoever can find out how to pass this section without using a homing attack. If some method is found, I'll post it in the pinned comment and description, so make sure to check there to see if someone's already done it. If somebody does find out how to do this, I'll make a follow-up video crediting them and showcasing how to do it. We are going to get past this. If you're interested in trying out how to do this, then join my Discord server and we can talk about it there with me and others who might be attempting this as well. There's a link in the description of every single video. I know that $20 isn't really much to offer, considering I'm basically asking you to do something impossible, but hey, this game has some really weird physics and really weird mechanics. I think there might be something we can exploit here. Once again, thanks to Proa for helping out with this challenge. I feel like I say that at the end of all of my videos now, but he does help out a lot. If you enjoyed this video, then subscribing helps out a ton, and liking the video helps out as well. And if you want to be notified of all of my future uploads, make sure to hit the notification bell to join the Billis Squad. I'm gonna have to work on that. Also, join my Discord server and follow me on Twitter, please. They're in every single description of the video, and my Twitter followers are like zero compared to my YouTube subscribers, so please, please, please. And with that, I would like to thank you all so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next video. Goodbye.